Any more questions on the framework? So once again, it's financials, it is customer, client, that is the company itself, and the competitor, 3 C's, and product, that's the 3 C's and B that we need to have here. And the last two things that we should not forget are go-to-market strategy and the risks involved. These are the things that you typically, your answer is somewhere in those statements for marketing and business. Yeah. Channel should be one of them. It should be in one of the bullets. So chat, that's a question. I mean, right? You don't know if it is important or not.
As part of the interview, do you expect the candidate to pose a question which is brought by what are the implementation challenges or what are the distribution
challenges? Implementation challenges are bigger buckets. You don't want to talk about smaller buckets.
Talk about bigger buckets.
Because implementation challenges versus what you said is distribution challenges, right? Implementation challenges might also have management attention, right? Whereas distribution challenges are smart. And this one is a bigger problem. If you don't have any management attention, that's a bigger problem, right? So keep your buckets broader.
I'm not getting any kind of questions from this crowd.
After we have evaluated each and every factor, we would like to go deeper into one of the factors. Is it the case or suppose I'm stuck at the economic analysis factors and then the interviewer says that you know this is the place you should venture into. Should I leave all the other factors or should I cover first of all saying that you know there's coal and then I would like to cover the all the factors and then
the sentence you are defined giving you a hint is following. Yeah. I'm giving you the answer right there, right? Please follow my answer.
So the next page is the money page for me. This is the most important, like one of the three most important pages for me. And as an interviewer, right? How am I evaluating a candidate? If I saw somewhere in these, if I get the white sheets and if I see a long laundry list of things. I'm not going to give you a second chance. I'm not going to even evaluate the next two things. I mean, a candidate. So let's. So a candidate has to be good across all these factors. And when I say good, the level of answers that I am giving, right? Or the level of responses that you saw on the sheet. That is the level, that's the best case possible. And if you are not there across any of these factors, that is fine, but you need to make it up in the next one, right? You need to make it up in the third one. So there is a math question, right? In the case, let's assume that you are not doing a great job at structuring the problem, fine, okay? If you say that, okay, this, if I say that, okay, this guy did a decent job, right? That's fine, he's not force-fitting the framework, he's not comprehensive, but he's at least not force-fitting the framework, that's fine, but he solved the problem in the best way possible, okay, I'll take him to the next problem. But if he's not even solving the math problem in the best way possible, if he's a new moderate guy in the math, if he's a moderate guy in the structuring the problem, no, he's not being qualified into the next problem. But just feel free to ask the question. So this is what I'm talking about, a moderate versus a good candidate versus the best candidate possible, right? When I'm taking, when I'm an interviewer, when I'm doing this stuff, when I was preparing for my own cases, I didn't get this kind of information. It's very tough to get this level of details. So if you are here, right, If you are, let's say, doing a laundry list, if you don't have a proper structure, don't try to become another forget, don't try to be more creative, don't try to be comprehensive. First, go into a framework. Understand all the frameworks. It's actually not a good thing, but that's the basic requirement. You need to know what's the framework to solve a profitability case. It's not whether it's just not revenues and costs, there's much more to it. It's not, so don't come with a laundry list, it really annoys anybody. Come up with at least a framework. That's level two. And both of these are in red zone, by the way. Right? If it's a red zone, break it down. And the next thing is well-structured answers and being comprehensive. I 80% comprehensiveness is fine enough. You don't need to answer all the questions. That's the level D guy. And the best candidate possible, right, is identifying the dependencies, which are actually relevant dependencies. So if the guy comes up and says, again, you don't know what the dependency is not, so give it a shot. That's the reason why I said connecting the dots. Within a question and across questions is the most important thing. Across in any case, you know. Don't miss that. It's very easy as well. You know you can connect definitely brand image versus location, location versus competition, right? These kind of things. So that's the, this is where you guys should be. For example, right? You came with a list of things, right? You can just show the arrows.
Arrow is interdependent with most of the time complicated and brand. So this will be like an evergreen thing. You will always have an interdependence between ROI and
But again, the problem with that is, right, it's not useful to be a mark specific exact. There's no case of interviewer to go and check, right? And if you don't check, at the end of the day when they are evaluating all the candidates, they can't really see who said what. That's the difficulty. So being specific helps to use the mark.
So this is where, so across the three things that I mentioned, right, connecting the dots, structuring the problem, and solving the math, if structuring the problem is going to be your strength, you have the math. Okay? And what's the, and I've read a great quote recently, and it says that, what's the worst enemy of being the best guy possible? Is that if you are a good guy, you don't even try to be here. So if you are here, you will at least keep working, and there is absolutely there. But if you think that, oh, I'm good, and I don't need to work hard, it's okay. You can work hard for a couple of days, and you will be here. Right? So the best, so the enemy of the best guy is always the self being called a good guy. So try to be the best guy. Good. So let's move into the, from the structure, let's move into the second part, the quant, and see how we can do the best way possible in the quant. Any questions? Any more questions? Yeah.
So the brand you spoke about was in Singapore for 7 years and it had 10 outlets.
Yeah.
What relevant, the most relevant information I can derive from there? Like, I know it's trying to enter India, but the fact that it has already been operating for 7 years in Singapore, is there any knowledge that I can use?
There's a question in there.
From him. You can disconnect.
Just take it out.
Here, this one, tablet, yeah. There's an option.
That yield at least 25% return on investment at the end of third year. So I repeat, they have a strict investment policy that they invest in companies that yield at least 25% return on investment at the end of third year. So when we go ahead and when we looked into the financials of Bangalore, what we got from is that they have an estimated profit margin of 20%. Year over year, right, on an annual basis. For the next 3 years, that's expected to be the same. And the revenues are expected to be $6 million this year, all on the same denominations, so the revenues are expected to be $6 million this year. So what will be the maximum purchase price that Alpha will be willing to pay for annual lease following their current investment policy? So there's a common kind of question, not a question. So, any questions for the guys who do not look on the screen?
Yeah.
What is the growth rate? Did you see the growth rate?
This one. Any questions, guys? Yeah. If anything has finished, just give me the sheet. And then you. Or just let me know and I'll come over and see. Okay. Show step one. So this is the total revenue for the next 3 years. So I will say that for this $6 million for this year, for the next 6 times 1.1, there's a 10% growth rate attached. Right? And plus another 1.4 times 2, 3, 6. Right? This is the total revenue for the next 3 years. Right? What's the question? The question is, what would we need to do for following the current investment policy? And their investment policy is that they need at least a 25% return on their existing investment. Right? So this is the revenue base. A lot of you said 14, 12, 13, right?
15.8.
Yeah, something like that. No, that is revenue. So let's assume this is $20 million. Okay, 6 times 6 plus 6 plus 6 times 1.1. So this is the revenue. This is not something that Bangalore Beach is getting. The profit. So I gave a piece of information which is profit, 20%. So that profit is on 20, it's 4 million. On that, so that's my next step. I say the profit is 20% times 20 million. So that is 4. So that's the 4 million on which I need to look on the ROI. So, yeah.
Is it necessary that you have to break it down into revenue and profit?
Yes.
Can't you just find out the profit directly?
That's fine. There is a risk. So guys, so good question. What she asked is, can you come up with directly note, why do we need to show this $20 million number? Why can't I show directly $4 million? Right? So, I mean, there's another very good thing that usually in the consulting companies, what you say, right? No communication is like more communication. Okay? So talk as much as you want, show as much as you can. Okay? Don't congest. The problem is, right? If you're miscalculating at this step versus this step, if the interviewer knows that, okay, you're making a mistake here, he'll immediately point out, oh, she made a very small mistake on 20% of 20 instead of 5. Instead of 4, she made 5. That's fine. So I can give you that answer. But if the overall answer that you give me is 5 million, I don't know where you made this. I really can't help you at that point. So break it down, break the problem, show the steps. And on top of this, the step 3 is nothing but ROI. ROI is nothing but profit minus the investment by investment. So that comes out to any.
3.2.
No, no, no. That's what I'm trying to say, right? I mean, I don't want to make this as a math, right?
So that is 3.2.
It's fine. I can't make this a math, right? But 20 million is the revenue. The return on investment is nothing but a profit equation. So you need to say that my return is only 4 million for the next 3 years. So you won't. So the return that I'm getting is 4 million. So I can't invest more than 4 million at any point. Right? So if I invest 15, let's say if I invest 12 million or 16 million, and if I get only 4 million for the next 3 years, so how much is the ROI? It can't be 25%. Right? That's the number, simple number mistake. And if I know that you are making the mistake only at the last step, I can give you some data. Okay, guys, any questions? Alright guys, so let's actually move on. This is not a math question. Guys,
what's the final answer?
3.1. Oh, what's the final answer? Somebody put it 3.17. Yes, that's the answer. 3.17. You can round it up. 3.2 works to if you have
asked. 0.25.
So it is. Your 25% is your return on investment. So 25% is your final answer, and that is nothing but your profit minus investment upon investment, right? And your investment is X, so you say 1.25X equal to profit 4 million. Right. So let's move ahead. This is not a math problem. Let's look at how are you evaluated on this. Right? How are you evaluated on this question? If you come up with 15 million, I'll put you on level 1 straight away. Or anything more than 4 million, right? Level 1. Right? If you show me the steps like this, even if you come up with 15 million, I'll put you in level 2. Or I'll try to push you into level 3. Remember that the interviewer is always helping you. If you show me the steps, and if you come up with 15 million, 14 million, whatever the number is, I still give you a second chance within the same question, and I will put you in this or this bucket. Depending on, I will explain you the entire equation. I did that with a lot of candidates for the same question. Again, similar kind of questions, and people usually come up with the right answers with a little bit of nudge. So I put them over here or here, and somebody who is showing me the structure, who has come up with the right answer, and also asked me a bit growth question, I'll not even ask a second math question. But if somebody is either here or here, level 2, right, I'll ask another math question. This is how usually works. I mean, there is no hard and fast rule. Everybody does things differently. But this is how usually, yeah. So that depends again on the company. Guys, great question. Guys, the question that was asked was, does the interviewer already has in mind that, okay, I am giving a bonus point for the growth, or I am not giving the bonus point for the growth? Am I on this side or am I on this side? Right? That depends on the company, whether it's an interviewer-led case or an interviewee-led case. If it's an interviewer-led case, he has an answer. He has a response sheet or an answer. I have an answer. I don't do this math every time I go to an interview. Right? I have these numbers and I have usually some prompts saying that give a bonus point to this guy if he asks this, he's something. And I do that. Right? And somebody is making my life easier. I do that. Yeah.
When you show the response sheet of that market analysis competition, like what he will be having, so one point over there was the market size. But I'm unable to understand, like, what kind of question can I frame around that? Like, I cannot simply ask him directly. Right?
The questions are, that's a great question. I missed something over here. When you are structuring the initial solution, right, how do you talk with the interviewer? How do you say that, okay, I want to look into why are you entering the new market? I want to. So that's a common question, right? How do you frame the question for any piece of factor that you want to talk, that you want to talk about, right? It's not just about market size. It depends on the question that the interviewer is asking. So sometimes the question is, what are the factors that you would consider, right? Or sometimes the question is, what is the hypothesis? Can you come up with certain hypotheses? Right? Can you tell me what are the implications of doing that? Different ways of forming the question. If the interviewer is saying that, okay, what are your hypotheses? How do you frame your hypothesis? Then my answer will be different. If this response is right, why? Somebody asks you, what are the analysis that you would conduct? So three kinds of questions, right? One, what are the kinds of analysis that you want to conduct for this problem statement? So this is the problem statement. Your responses, the way you frame your responses, differs by the nature of the question. Right? So the first kind of question is, what are the analysis that you want to conduct to understand if it is better than the market? That's the first kind of question. The second kind of question is, what are the hypotheses that you can derive out of this, that those guys should go and evaluate? Right? Number three is, what are the factors that you would consider? Your core factors, your core issue tree is the same, but the way you frame your response should be different. You cannot say, what are the analysis you would conduct? You cannot say, oh, we should, what is presence? Brazil's market size is X and X. Your question, it can't be a question, right? It has to be a question. It can't be a statement. Right? Similarly, for a hypothesis, it can't be a question. So for analysis, I would go and analyze what is the market size of Brazil, what is the market size of, what is the ROI, so that's my response, typical response. Now you know, right, how do you frame your sentences, depending on the question. Any questions on that? It's very important to frame your answers in the right way. All right. This is how you need to look for your match response. Most of the guys that I have graduated, if you are good at structure, so the first two factors, structuring the problem and solving the problem, go hand in hand. I have not seen people who are really, really good at this and who don't do really well there. So this is how you should be. So if you are not a level 4 guy in math, you have to be a level 4 guy in structuring the problem.